In a previous video, which you find attached to this video, I did set up an EC2 instance to run a web server, a Node.js demo website web server, and we went through all the steps that were required to start that instance, download that code onto that instance, run that web server, give it the appropriate permissions, since the web server or the web application also needed to write to a file. And by the end, we therefore had that web server up and running. But of course, in that video, we also had to go through a lot of steps to get there. In this video here, we're going to repeat the process, but we're going to write way less commands. Actually, no commands at all, because that's also possible with EC2. Now, just as with that previous video, this video here is not there to teach you EC2 or AWS from the ground up. Instead, it's there to give you a better understanding of how you could work with EC2 if you want to learn what AWS and EC2 and all the other AWS services are all about. You might want to check out my AWS Cloud Practitioner course, which also helps you pass that first entry-level AWS certification. Now, in this video, as mentioned, we're going to start an EC2 instance, a virtual server in the cloud. Therefore, I'll head back to my EC2 console, and I want to launch a new instance here. However, this time, we're going to do some things differently. Not regarding the core settings, though. We will stick to Amazon Linux as an AMI, or to be precise, we'll pick an Amazon Linux-based AMI. So we're going to use the machine image that gives us an Amazon Linux operating system installation on that instance. For the instance type, I choose T2 Micro so that I can use this free tier since this is a brand new account. I don't need a key pair because I won't connect to that instance via local SSH, and actually also not in any other way because we won't need to connect, as you will see. And regarding the network settings, I'll stick to the default here and I'll choose an existing security group, which is that security group I created earlier in that other video where I accept HTTP and SSH traffic. If you don't have that security group because you didn't follow along with that earlier video, you can of course also create a new one. Just make sure that you do allow HTTP traffic. And actually, we can do that and even disable the SSH traffic part if you want to, because as mentioned, I don't plan on connecting to that instance at all. So now that I think about it, let's take this route. Let's create a brand new security group, which does not accept any SSH traffic from anywhere, and let's just accept HTTP traffic. Now we keep the storage defaults, but now this time, we're also going to dive into these advanced details here. And to be precise, I want to dive into this user data setting here, because that is the part that will help us with automating that instance configuration and the installation of the web server. It will help us with downloading the code and all these things. Now, how does this user data feature help us? Well, it helps us by allowing us to insert a script that should be executed right after the instance started. You could call it a bootstrapping script because it bootstraps the instance. It installs some software and sets up some settings so that the instance thereafter performs a certain task or is prepared to perform a certain task. And attached to this video, you also find my userdata.sh file. And the file extension isn't too important here. I just used it so that I get some formatting here in Visual Studio Code, the IDE, which I used for opening this, which you don't need though. And in this file, I have this line, which is important, which will tell AWS that this is a shell script that should be executed with help of the shell of that instance. So the command line process on that instance, so to say. And then I perform a couple of steps in there. I enable logs so that we could see what's going on in case things go wrong. And then I install Git. And if you recall that other video I mentioned before, there we also installed Git. But there we did it manually after connecting to the instance through SSH. Now here we tell AWS as part of that script that Git should be installed, and it will therefore be done automatically right after the instance started without us connecting to the instance and running this manually. And I do the same for all the other parts. I install NVM to then install Node.js. I then clone the website code. We just have to insert the URL of the website here. Then I install the dependencies of that website. Let's actually replace this with a dot here to make sure that we clone into this folder into which we navigated here. Then we install the dependencies. Then here we do create that folder and that file where this web server of that website which we're going to clone will write some data to. And then there's one important difference compared to that other video I mentioned. In that other video, we had to go through a couple of steps related to user permissions. Now, we don't need those here when using user data, so when passing a script here into this user data field, because the script which we can pass in here will be executed as the root user on that instance, not as that EC2 user, which has limited permissions, but as the root user, which has full permissions. Therefore, since the script will be executed by a user with unlimited permissions, so to say, we don't need to change any permissions because that user will already have all the permissions it needs. So therefore, we don't need to manage any permissions. Instead, we just create that folder and that file. Then we set up that port forwarding, which we also did in that other video. And then last but not least, we install PM2, which is a tool that allows us to run that Node.js web server in the background, and then that tool is used to run that process in the background. And that's it. That's that user data script. Now all we need to do is grab that GitHub URL and use that here in that user data script. And you find that finished script attached to the video where you don't need to change anything. And then we can copy the content of that script file and paste it here into this user data field. Just a short side note, there's one thing that was missing in my shell script here, in my user data script. We also need to navigate into that subfolder in the code base that we downloaded because it's in that subfolder where the actual app resides. So we need to navigate in there before we can run npm install or then later also start the app server. Again, the user data script you find attached contains all these changes and performs all the steps that must be performed. So these are now the steps that will be executed when that instance starts. This first line is important. Without that, AWS would not know that this is a script that should be executed, but with it, it does. And therefore, now we can launch this instance. And what this will do is it will create that instance, but right after the instance started, it will go through all these script steps. So therefore, we can, of course, view all instances and view that instance and wait for it to, well, to start running. Now, once the instance is up and running, you still might want to wait a couple of seconds or even minutes because only after it's running, this script, this user data script, will be executed, so it will not immediately be done. Hence, I'll wait for a couple of minutes just to be sure, and thereafter, we can grab this DNS or this public IP, which was assigned automatically, and use that to check whether we can see the website that should be served by that website server. With that, once the instance is up and running, we can grab that public DNS or public IP address as mentioned and visit that website with help of it. So this works just as before in that old video, but now this time it does so with help of that user data thing, and therefore starting this web server was of course way less work than before. Indeed, you only need a predefined script, and then you can easily use that on as many instances as you want, and therefore this of course makes it super simple to repeat that same process on multiple instances and start that same web server on multiple instances. So that's of course way easier than having to connect to all these instances and going through all the steps you saw in that other video all the time, every time, for every instance. So that's the advantage of using user data for bootstrapping an instance.